On this Pentecost Sunday morning, we have gathered together to worship the Lord our God and to give him praise and glory. May the Spirit indeed be in our midst and guide us so that we will worship in spirit and in truth. I should introduce myself, although it's been my privilege to come as a guest minister for some 40 years here to the church, Maranatha Church. But there may be some who don't know me. I'm Reverend Gregg Martin. I'm a retired pastor, and I'm very happy and thankful to be with you this morning. May God bless us. Our help stands in the name of the Lord who made the heavens and the earth. Grace, mercy, and peace be unto you from God the Father and from Jesus Christ his Son, by the working of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Let's now do our call to worship. God will pour out the Spirit on all flesh, and our daughters and sons shall prophesy. Our old ones shall dream dreams, and our young ones shall see visions. All who call upon the name of the Lord shall be delivered.
Well, daughters and sons of our God, let us join singing Wonderful Merciful Savior to our Wonderful Merciful Savior.
Wonderful Merciful Savior, precious Redeemer, you
I think you may be seated. The Spirit of the Lord fills the world and knows our every word and deed. Let us then open ourselves to the Lord and confess our sins in penitence and faith. Let us pray. You raise the dead to life in the Spirit. Lord, have mercy. You bring pardon and peace to the broken in heart. Christ, have mercy. You make one by your Spirit the torn and divided. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
All the promises of God find their yes in Christ. That is why we utter the Amen through him to the glory of God. It is God who has put his seal upon us and given us his Spirit in our hearts as a guarantee. In Christ, by the power of the Spirit, we are redeemed. Praise God, from whom all blessings flow.
Let's pray this prayer to the Spirit, that he would breathe on us and fill us.
Breathe on me, breath of God, fill me with life anew, that I may love the way you love, and do what you would do. Breathe on me, till my heart is pure, until my will is one with yours, to do and to and you. Breathe on me, breath of God, till breathe on me, breath of God, so shall I never die, but live with you the perfect life for all eternity. Help me,
in his wisdom and in his mercy, God himself has given us guideposts for Christian living, so that, having the Spirit at work in our hearts, we will seek to do the will of God. Let us listen carefully now to this rule for holy living given to us by the Lord in his good commandments. And God spoke all these words, I am the Lord your God who brought you out of Egypt, out of the land of slavery. You shall have no other gods before me. You shall not make for yourself an idol in the form of anything, in heaven above or on the earth beneath or in the waters below. You shall not bow down to them or worship them, for I, the Lord your God, am a jealous God. punishing the children for the sin of the fathers, to the third and fourth generation of those who hate me, but showing love to 1,000 generations of those who love me and keep my commandments. You shall not misuse the name of the Lord your God, for the Lord will not hold anyone guiltless who misuses his name. Remember the Sabbath day by keeping it holy. 6 days you shall labor and do all your work, but the seventh day is a Sabbath to the Lord your God. On it you shall not do any work, neither you nor your son or daughter, nor your manservant or maidservant, nor your animals, nor the alien within your gates. For in 6 days the Lord made the heavens and the earth, the sea and all that is in them, but he rested on the seventh day. Therefore the Lord blessed the Sabbath day and made it holy. Honor your father and your mother, so that you may live long in the land the Lord your God is giving you. You shall not murder. You shall not commit adultery. You shall not steal. You shall not give false testimony against your neighbor. You shall not covet your neighbor's house. You shall not covet your neighbor's wife, or his manservant or maidservant, his ox or donkey, or anything that belongs to your neighbor. Jesus said, "You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind, and with all your strength. This is the first and great commandment. And a second like unto it is this, you shall love your neighbor as yourself. On these two commandments depend all of God's law and the prophets." Now, let's join our hearts together and turn to the Lord in our congregational prayer this Pentecost Sunday morning. Let us pray. O holy, gracious, merciful God, Holy Trinity, one God, one divine essence, yet in a way beyond our human understanding, always existing in three persons, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. On this Pentecost Sunday morning, Lord, we give you glory and thanks because in your love and mercy, you have sent the Holy Spirit upon your church, and you have sent your Spirit into our hearts, working within our hearts that marvelous gift of faith, together with hope and love, the greatest of all spiritual gifts. O Lord, we pray that the Spirit will so work within the hearts of each one of us that we may humble ourselves before you and acknowledge that we are sinners, that we cannot save ourselves, that whatever good we think we do cannot earn us an entrance into your heavenly kingdom. O Lord, we know it is only by the perfect work of Jesus, accomplished for us on the cross and in the power of his resurrection, that we are able to come before you and to ask, Lord, that you will indeed forgive us, that you will grant us your pardon, and then draw us close to you in fellowship. Lord God, we thank you for that fellowship that we have with you through the powerful work of the Spirit. And we thank you too, Lord, for the blessing that we have as part of this congregation where you have called us. We pray for Maranatha Church. Lord God, you know the need for a pastor here. We pray that in your good time and according to your purpose, he will be found and will serve you in the midst of this congregation. We also thank you, Lord, for the fellowship that we enjoy Sunday by Sunday with brothers and sisters in the faith as we bring before you this sacrifice of praise, our worship. We know, Lord, that there are reasons here in the midst of the congregation to thank and praise you, and that we do, Lord. We praise you for the blessing that you have given to Richard Lisa, that he could graduate this past week. We thank you, Lord, for that accomplishment, that you have given him the time and talents to accomplish this. And we pray for your blessing on his life ahead as he uses what he has learned to put his talents to good use. We thank you also that our brother Albert Hartholt could look forward to celebrating another birthday in the week ahead. We pray that you will be with him and strengthen him, and we acknowledge your goodness toward him. Heavenly Father, there are also needs here. Some are known publicly, others are held privately. But you know, Lord, the need that each one of us has. And particularly this morning, we pray for families of the congregation who are under stress. Lord God, we live in difficult and challenging times, and so often that can weigh heavily upon our hearts and minds and souls. We ask that your Spirit will indeed be the counselor and comforter that those who are under stress need. Lord God, we pray not just for ourselves, but we pray for the worldwide work of your church, for the cause of missions, as missionaries here at home and in foreign lands bring the gospel message to those who have never heard or who have heard but not yet responded. We ask, Lord, that there may be fruit upon their labor and that you will gather in your elect, even as you have promised, from every tribe and nation, every kindred and tongue, until that number is complete and Jesus returns. Lord God, we also pray for all the difficulties and troubles in this world, that you will work in such a way to turn the hearts of those who are in power, that they will seek to do good, that they will seek not just their own interest or narrow party interest, but that they will realize that their calling is to seek the common good for the peoples over whom they rule. And may that be true here among us in Canada, here in the province of Ontario, and in the local municipalities in which we live. Lord God, we think of the violence that goes on here in our own community more and more, but also in the world. We think of the ongoing violence in the Ukraine and ask, Lord, that if it be possible, you will work to turn the heart of Mr. Putin away from the violence and destruction that he has ordered inflicted upon the suffering people there in the Ukraine. Oh Lord, we look to you and we bring all of this together with our personal requests and the desires of our hearts before your throne of grace. Oh Lord, be pleased to answer us in the way that is best for us, granting us in this world a knowledge of your truth, and in the world to come, life everlasting through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Eyes before we hear the word being spoken to us, and pray for the Spirit's leading and also for the Spirit to change us.
And now we open the scriptures. Before I turn to the major part of the scripture this morning, which will be from the Gospel of John, since it is Pentecost Sunday, I want to read just a few verses from Acts chapter 2, where in the Word of God, the great event of Pentecost is described. So from Acts chapter 2, just a few verses there. When the day of Pentecost came, they were all together in one place. Suddenly a sound like the blowing of a violent wind came from heaven and filled the whole house where they were sitting. They saw what seemed to be tongues of fire that separated and came to rest on each of them. All of them were filled with the Holy Spirit and began to speak in other languages as the Spirit enabled them. And now we turn to the 14th chapter of John's Gospel, where we have Jesus' wonderful promise regarding the coming of the Holy Spirit. John 14, I'm going to start reading with verse 1 and read through verse 17. Words of Jesus. Do not let your hearts be troubled. Trust in God. Trust also in me. In my Father's house are many rooms. If it were not so, I would have told you. I am going there to prepare a place for you. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come back and take you to be with me, that you also may be where I am. You know the way to the place where I am going." Thomas said to him, "Lord, we don't know where you are going, so how can we know the way?" Jesus answered, "I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. If you really knew me, you would know my Father as well. From now on, you do know him and have seen him." Philip said, "Lord, show us the Father, and that will be enough for us." Jesus answered, "Don't you know me, Philip, even after I have been among you such a long time? Anyone who has seen me has seen the Father. How can you say, 'Show us the Father'? Don't you believe that I am in the Father and the Father is in me? The words I say to you are not just my own. Rather, it is the Father living in me who is doing his work. Believe me when I say that I am in the Father and the Father is in me, or at least believe on the evidence of the miracles themselves. I tell you the truth, anyone who has faith in me will do what I have been doing. He will do even greater things than these because I am going to the Father. And I will do whatever you ask in my name so that the Son may bring glory to the Father. You may ask me for anything in my name and I will do it. If you love me, you will obey what I command. And I will ask the Father, and he will give you another counselor to be with you forever, the Spirit of Truth. The world cannot accept him because it neither sees him nor knows him, but you know him, for he lives with you and will be in you." So far, these verses from John 14, and for our text, the words of Jesus in verse 16, "I will ask the Father, and he will give you another counselor to be with you forever, the Spirit of Truth." Congregation of the Spirit of Christ, today is a special day. Today is a day of celebration and joy. It is Pentecost Sunday. And for all of us who believe in the Lord Jesus Christ and take him at his word, this is a very special day. It's a day of rejoicing because the Spirit is ours. It is a time to remember that, yes, Christ Jesus sent his Spirit, and his Spirit lives with us, among us, and in our hearts. It's a day to reflect upon what is written there in Acts chapter 2, that great event when the Spirit came down upon the disciples in such a mighty way. And we live in this day and age when the Spirit who came at Pentecost is still here among us, guiding us and directing us, blessing us here in the Church of Jesus Christ. We live in a day and age when the Spirit of God is no longer the forgotten person of the Holy Trinity. We have to confess that for many, many years, centuries indeed, among most all of the Protestant churches, it's not that the Spirit was forgotten, no, it's not that the Spirit was not confessed as the third person of the Holy Trinity, no, but not much was made of the Spirit and his work. But things have changed, certainly so. It's important for us to remember the mighty works of the Spirit in times past, but also what the Spirit of God is doing today. And that is important. It's vital to the spiritual life of each and every one of us as God's Spirit works within our hearts. It's vital in the life of a congregation. But not all that we hear is encouraging, however. We must confess that we hear of disputes about the Spirit and His work. There are vast differences in how the Scriptures are interpreted, differences of understanding regarding spiritual gifts. Some today who call themselves Christians say, well, they have the Spirit of God, while, well, other lesser Christians do not. Some claim to have received the Spirit, and then the very first thing they do is to cause trouble or break the fellowship of the church and void their professions of faith. When the Bible says that the fruit of the Spirit, the evidence of the Spirit, is peace and long-suffering and a humble heart. It all goes to show, dear brothers and sisters in Christ Jesus, that we need to be careful. The Spirit of God is like a flame of fire. Now, when we make good and right use of fire, it's a great help to us. It gives us heat and light and energy, the things which we need. But if you misuse fire, oh, it burns and hurts and destroys, as certainly we've seen in these last few weeks with the tremendous wildfires in Alberta. We want the work of the Spirit to be a blessing upon us. Yes, indeed. We don't want to get burned spiritually. And so on this Pentecost Sunday, we have turned to the Gospel of John. There we discover words of Jesus himself, words in which Jesus tells us his purpose, his intention in sending the Holy Spirit upon his bride, the church. Reread that purpose of the Lord Jesus here in John chapter 14. Now, to the surprise of some, perhaps, here in this chapter, the Lord Jesus does not even mention certain controversial gifts. He does not say that some of his disciples will receive the Spirit and others not. No. These issues are the result of people's weakness and not the Lord's intention. In our text, the Lord Jesus declares that he and the Father have sent the Holy Spirit to be our counselor forever. According to the Word of God, the Spirit of God sent in wondrous fulfillment there of Jesus' promise at Pentecost was for a clear purpose. And the Spirit came not first of all to be the giver of spectacular gifts, not first of all to set our emotions on fire, but the Spirit was sent to be our counselor forever. Let's consider then on this Pentecost Sunday morning the task of a counselor and how we might find the Holy Spirit, his blessing upon each one of us by being such a counselor in our hearts and in our lives. And the first task of a counselor is to give comfort. When we have smooth sailing in life, when our troubles are few and our pleasures are many, we feel no need, no desire to have a counselor. When life is easy, we feel self-sufficient. We enjoy that feeling of independence, and we can say to others, hey, I stand on my own two feet. I don't need the help of anyone else. Oh, but life's circumstances can change in an instant. And when we are battered by life's storms, when troubles come and are many, when we are weighed down with grief, sorrows, troubles of all kinds, and when our problems bring us to the very brink of despair, then if we are wise, we will seek a counselor. Then if we have some sanctified common sense, we will seek help. We will search for someone to give us a word of wise advice and encouragement. We will feel our need for a counselor, someone to give us confidence, someone to set our feet on that right path. And the task of a counselor in such circumstances is to do exactly that, to give to the needy person that which they need, to touch that troubled soul with comfort. Elsewhere in Scripture, the Holy Spirit is called the Comforter. And as our heavenly counselor, the Spirit gives us comfort. And that comfort comes from faith. That gift of the Spirit of God at work within our hearts, bringing to life and strengthening that trust that we have in God and His promises. The faith that the Spirit gives, that faith is our source of strength. Yes, it is a blessing that we receive from the Spirit. And the Spirit comforts us with assurance. Assurance that the trials of life, which are very real, nevertheless last but for a moment, while an eternity with the Lord awaits those who believe in the world which is to come. And the Spirit comforts us with peace. Amidst all the restless changes that trouble the world today, we believers can have peace in our hearts because we know the unchanging gospel of Jesus Christ. We know that the Lord Jesus surrounds us with His comforting love. For each and every one of us, there comes that time in life when we feel pressure, when our hearts are heavy because of private grief, when life itself seems to be a burden. O troubled one, O restless soul, in your time of need, remember that Christ has prayed to God the Father, and in answer, the Father has sent the Holy Spirit. Open your heart to the Spirit's work, and you will know God's comfort. The second task of the Spirit, or of any counselor, is to give advice. Few people are as annoying as a know-it-all. Those who think that they have no need of advice, but that they know everything that is needed, such people are headed for a disaster. A haughty spirit comes before a fall, says the Word of God in the book of Proverbs. Those who are wise seek good advice. They seek it before they make any major decision in life. And a counselor's job is to give good, sound advice to those who ask for it. Being wise enough to ask for and listen to a counselor's advice can literally be a matter of life and death. Back in the 1800s, during the Indian Wars in the American West, General George Armstrong Custer, maybe some of you have heard that name, General Custer led a detachment of cavalry then. Now, scouts for the army warned Custer about something, but Custer was a very arrogant, stubborn, headstrong man, and he didn't listen to the advice that was given. The scouts told him, "Listen, there is going to be a major uprising among the Sioux Indians." But Custer didn't listen. And he led his men out onto the Montana prairies, where a large party of Sioux warriors under their chief, Sitting Bull, were waiting for him. And there was a battle at the Little Bighorn, and General Custer and 267 of his men were killed in that battle because Custer did not listen to advice. The Holy Spirit is our counselor as Christians. The Holy Spirit is described in Scripture as the Spirit of truth. His advice to you and me, to all Christians, is trustworthy 100%, and he speaks to us today in his word of truth, the Bible, that he has inspired. Through his word, the Spirit of God guides and directs those who will listen to him. And the Spirit is faithful. And he will guide us, the people of the Lord, each step of life's way. And we will worship and praise him at last forever. What a blessing. Our task now is to be humble enough to recognize that we don't know it all. No. We need the Spirit of truth to guide us by the word that he inspired, to guide us into all truth, because that is his task as the counselor. To give that sound, life-saving advice to all who will listen to him in their time of need. And the task of a counselor is to give protection. If we wander alone, restless, self-absorbed down life's pathway, we will soon run into danger. Because along that path, the devil has placed all kinds of traps and pitfalls. And that's a danger for anyone walking alone. But a good counselor gives direction for the path ahead. And following the direction given by the Spirit, we receive protection from harm and danger. And a real counselor is a friend who will guide us aright. That we surely need as we walk life's path through a dangerous and uncertain world. The first disciples, as we read, as Jesus himself describes at the beginning of John chapter 14, the first disciples had Jesus himself. He was right there with him. they received from the Lord himself warnings and guidance and direction. But the Lord Jesus knew that the time was coming when his earthly ministry would be complete. He would ascend to his Father in heaven, and his disciples would still need his divine guidance and counsel. That is why Jesus promised another counselor, one who would be with the church forever. And that counselor is the Spirit of Truth. On this Pentecost Sunday, we celebrate the Spirit's presence in our midst as a congregation. We praise God for the Spirit's direction within our hearts. And we gladly receive his divine protection, because we know that if we follow the Spirit as he directs us in his word of truth, we will be kept safe and secure. Not just now, but forever. For the Spirit is indeed our counselor forever. On this Pentecost Sunday 2023, we disciples of Jesus remember that God the Father poured out the Holy Spirit in a special way. We celebrate the fact that the Spirit came and gives saving faith. He gave it to the saints in the Old Testament. He gives it to us in these New Testament days. And those who believe are brought to salvation. But Pentecost Sunday is not just a day for remembering. It's a good day to take a spiritual inventory, you in your soul and me in mine. What do we expect of God the Holy Spirit? What purpose did Jesus have in sending the Holy Spirit? These are personal questions that demand an answer. Let us beware of the forces of this age that are greedy for special gifts and distinctions and emotional highs and spiritual spectaculars. Christ's purpose in sending the Spirit, as he tells us in the gospel, is far different. The Lord Jesus promised to pray to God the Father and to ask the Father to send another counselor. This the Father did at Pentecost in Jerusalem long ago. The Spirit was given. And within the church today, the Spirit is still here because he is with us forever. Hear us then, as we turn to the Lord, each one, and seek his divine counsel. Let us have hearts that seek what he offers, comfort, that is, faith, assurance, the peace that we need in this life, strength for each day, courage to help us overcome life's trials. He offers the advice of truth, which is not always easy for our sinful hearts to accept. But those who are wise listen to the Spirit as he speaks to us through the Bible, that word that he inspired. And he offers protection. By trusting this counselor, we gain a friend whose careful guidance keeps us from harm and danger. That is the Spirit's task. For this purpose, he came and he filled the church at Pentecost. By simple faith and by the use of the means of grace, may he fill your heart and mine today. May our hearts and lives be always open to the counselor whom Jesus sent. Yes, the Spirit of truth. Let us be content with his good counsel. Let us seek nothing more, and let us be content with nothing less. For he is the Spirit of truth, who will guide us on through life. And Jesus promises that his Spirit will be with us, with you and me, forever. Amen. Let us pray. Spirit of God, we acknowledge your great power. And Lord, we ask you, please, to open our hearts in such a way that by true faith we receive you as you are, our counselor, giving us guidance and direction, leading us into all truth, keeping us safe on the path of life. Spirit of God, grant your blessing to us and to all Christians, so that having been kept safe and secure through the course of our earthly life, we may join all the saints in glory and there praise and glorify you forever. Hear this, our prayer. We ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. Jesus says in Matthew 25, "Well done, good and faithful servant. You have been faithful with a few things. I will put you in charge of many things. Come and share your master's happiness." In that spirit, I remind you that you have an opportunity to give your offering for Resonate Global Mission, which is collected as you exit the sanctuary.
As we close our worship, let us stand up and sing this song of praise to our King of Kings who sent the Spirit.
We were waiting without hope, without light, till from heaven you came running. There was mercy in your eyes to fulfill the law and prophets. To a virgin came the word from a throne of endless glory to a cradle in the dirt. till that stone was moved for good, for the Lamb had conquered death, and the dead rose from their tombs, and the angels stood in awe for the souls of all who come to the Father are restored. Today we celebrate the Church of Christ was born, and the Spirit lit the flame. Now this gospel drew the bold, shall not kneel, it shall not faint. By his blood and in his name, in his freedom I am free. For the love of Jesus Christ, who has resurrected me. Come on, church.
Now, as you go your way on into the week ahead, lift up your heart and receive from the Lord his benediction. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, the fellowship and communion of the Holy Spirit be and abide with you all evermore. Amen.